This conference will now be recorded.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to online revision class on VLSI Design. In this session, I am going to revise remaining units of VLSI Design. Anyway, the first concept is basic circuit concepts, in which sheet resistance. Sheet resistance is defined as the resistivity per thickness. The units of sheet resistance is ohms per square. Let us consider a uniform slab of material and calculate the resistance across the terminals A and B. You know the formula of resistance, RAB is equals to rho L by A. This area can be replaced by thickness into width. For a square slab of material, the length and width are same. That's why these two are cancel each other. The remaining is what? Rho by T only, which is nothing but a sheet resistance. In general, we can write the formula RAB is equals to this rho by T can be replaced by a sheet resistance, and the remaining term is what? L by W. That's why RAB is equals to rho S into L by W. This is the instrument which is used for the to measure a sheet resistance. This table shows the sheet resistance of mass layers for 5 micrometer, 2 micrometer and 1.2 micrometer. These are not exact values, these are the approximate values only. The n transistor channel resistance is 10 to the power 4, which means 10 kilo ohm. For 5 micrometer, the n channel sheet resistance is 10 kilo ohm. For p channel, it is equals to 2.5 into 10 to the power 4, which is equals to 25 kilo ohms. Remember these two values for the further calculations. Now I'm going to calculate the sheet resistance of a MOS transistors and inverters. This is n channel enhancement MOS transistor only. The length is 2 lambda, width is also 2 lambda. In case of NMOS depletion mode transistor, the length is 2 lambda and width is the width is 2 lambda and length is 8 lambda. Now we are going to calculate the sheet resistance. Channel length is 2 lambda and channel width is 2 lambda. What is the sheet resistance formula? I can say that R is equals to RS into L by W. L is 2 lambda and W is also 2 lambda. These two get cancelled each other. Remaining you get sheet resistance is 10 kilo ohms only. Similarly, for depletion mode transistor, length is 8 lambda, width is 2 lambda. That's why channel resistance is what? 10 kilo ohm multiplied by 8 lambda by 2 lambda. 2 lambda, 8 lambda, we are getting 4 only. That's why we are getting 40 kilo ohms. The channel resistance for depletion mode NMOS transistor is 40 kilo ohms. Similarly, for NMOS inverter, this is a pull-up transistor. This one is a pull-down transistor. Pull-up transistor is having the ratio 4 is to 1. For this, the pull-up resistance is given by the formula ZPU is equal to RS into L by W. Here RS is equal to what? From the table, it is 10 kilo ohm only. L by W is equal to 4 by 1. That's why ZPU is equal to 40 kilo ohms. Similarly, for pull down transistor, ZPD is equal to RS into L by W. Here sheet resistance for NMOS transistor is 10 kilo ohm. L by W is here 1 by 1. That's why we are getting 10 kilo ohm only. See, in case of NMOS transistor, if input is logic 1, then both the transistors are on. A short circuit is provided between VDD and ground terminal. That's why a static on resistance is equal to sum of pull-up resistance and pull-down resistance. That's why static on resistance is equal to 40 kilo ohms plus 10 kilo, which is equal to 50 kilo ohms. When it comes to CMOS inverter, the pull-up transistor is a PMOS transistor. The PMOS transistor is having the sheet resistance is equal to 25 kilo ohm from the table. Anyway, NMOS transistor is having the sheet resistance is equal to 10 kilo ohm. In this case, ZPU is equal to sheet resistance multiplied by L by W. Here also L by W is 1 by 1 only. That's why ZPU are getting 25 kilo ohms. For NMOS transistor, ZPD is equals to RS into L by W. Here RS is equals to 10 kilo ohm. L by W ratio is 1 by 1. Here we are getting 10 kilo ohms only. See, in case of CMOS inverter, there is no short circuit from VDD to ground terminal, even though input is either logic 0 or logic 1. That's why in CMOS inverter, there is no static CMOS. Next one, area capacitance. We know the general formula for capacitance. C is equals to epsilon A by D. Epsilon by
hello,
D. Hello.
Hello, Shiva. Sir, PPT is the first period degree, I think.
First period, I think.
PPT is the first period degree, I think.
Sir,
I'm
just.
Yes, sir. Sir, okay, sir. Hello, sir.
Is it visible? Okay.
Yes, sir.
Sir, is it visible, sir?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. The area capacitance of for 5 micrometer, 2 micrometer, and 1.2 micrometer. For gate to channel, it is having a value 4 into 10 to the power minus 4 micrometer square. The within bracket values indicates the relative values. For further calculation, I can refer this table only. Next one is standard unit of capacitance. The gate to channel capacitance of MOS transistor is known as standard unit of capacitance. It is denoted with box CZ only. For 5 micrometer technology, I'm going to calculate the standard unit of capacitance. We know the formula C is equals to epsilon A by D. Epsilon by D value can be taken from the table and we can calculate the area. For example, for 5 micrometer technology, area is equals to 5 micrometer into 5 micrometer. We get 25 micrometer square. Capacitance value is for 4 into 10 to the power minus 4 picofarad for micrometer square from the table only. From this, I can calculate the standard unit of capacitance. Box CZ is equals to 25 micrometer square multiplied by this value. You are getting a 0.01 picofarad. Similarly, for 2 micrometer technology, the area is 4 micrometer square and capacitance value from the table 8 into 10 to the power minus 4 picofarad meter square. And we get the standard unit of capacitance is multiplying these two values 0.0032 picofarad. Similarly, we can calculate the 1.2 micrometer also. The area is 1.44 micrometer square and the capacitance value from the table is 16 into 10 to the power minus 4 picofarad for micrometer square. From multiplying these two values, I'm getting a standard unit of capacitance as 0.0023 picofarad. Next one is area capacitance. The area capacitance is the product of relative area and relative C value. Again, the relative area can be calculated by using ratio of area of interest to area of standard gate. For example, I'm going to calculate the area capacitance. Area is having 20 lambda into 3 lambda. The relative area is given by required area by standard area. Standard area means 2 lambda by 2 lambda. Required area is what? 20 lambda multiplied by 3 lambda. By simplifying, we are getting 15 only. Now, capacitance to substrate is given by the formula relative area multiplied by the relative C value. This relative C value is obtained from the table only. And the relative area is what? 15. Multiplying these two values, I am getting area in metal 1, which is equals to 1.125 box CZ. Similarly, area in polysilicon, using the same formula only. The relative C value for the polysilicon is obtained from the table only, that is 0.1 CZ. the total value is multiplied by 1.5 into box CZ only. In general, we measure the unit as box CZ only. Similarly, for n-type diffusion, we can use the same formula. Here, area capacitance calculation more than one layer. First, we have to calculate the area capacitance for each layer individually by using the same formula only. Relative area multiplied by the relative C value. This relative C value is obtained from the table only. Anyway, this box CZ is the unit of this capacitance only. After calculating the area capacitance, all these individual layers, the total capacitance can be obtained by adding these, for example, capacitance of metal layer and capacitance of polysilicon, capacitance of gate layer. See, by calculate these capacitance by using the same formula only. That is what relative area multiplied by relative C value only. Next one is delay unit. Delay unit is defined as the time taken by the output to reach 63% of its final value. In general, delay unit is given by the formula RS into box CZ. RS is a sheet resistance. Box CZ is the standard unit of capacitance. For 5 micrometer technology, the RS value is 10 kilo ohm. Box CZ is equals to 0.01 picofarad. From this, I can calculate 0.1 nanosecond. Similarly, we can calculate 2 micrometer also. For 2 micrometer, the sheet resistance is given by 20 kilo ohm and the box CZ value is given by 0.0032 picofarad. By multiplying these two values, I can get the delay time. That is 0.064 nanoseconds. Next topic is inverter delay. See, two NMOS inverters are connected in cascade. Internally, this NMOS inverter consists of pull down is a NMOS transistor only. If input is changing from logic 0 to logic 1, then the pull down transistor of first NMOS inverter is on. Then the capacitor starts discharging through this pull down transistor, and this discharging time constant is given by RS into box CZ. RS into box CZ is nothing but our time constant only, which is equals to 1 tau. At the same time, if input is logic 0, if input is changing from 0 to 1 means what? If input is logic 1, output is 0. The input of second NMOS inverter is 0. That's why pull down transistor of second NMOS inverter is off. During this case, the capacitor starts charging through this pull-up transistor. This pull-up transistor is having the ratio 4:1. That's why the time constant, the charging time constant is given by 4 RS into box CZ. RS into box CZ is replaced by a time constant which is equals to 4 tau. The total time constant is equals to discharging time constant plus charging time constant, which is equals to 5 tau. Similarly, for CMOS inverter, my input is changing from 0 to 1. Here I am getting output is equals to 0 only. See, in case of NMOS inverter, this capacitance is box CZ. But in case of CMOS, I am using a capacitance value is 2 times box CZ. The reason is, in case of a CMOS inverter, the input is connected to gate of both PMOS transistor and NMOS transistor. That's why I can take the capacitance as a 2 times box CZ. If input is changing from 0 to 1, then the pull down transistor of this CMOS inverter is on. This capacitor starts charging through this pull down transistor. And this discharging time constant is given by 2 times box RS into box CZ.
Hello.
Hello. Sir, PPT slide. Hello, sir. PPT slide 8 degree. 8 slide. Area
capacitance
of values. I will ask the students.
Okay.
Any student from the students? Hello. Anyone student can respond. Hello. My voice is audible. Sheshi sir. ये
सर
स्लाइड
वॉइस
दिख रहा है सर,
इज
वाई स्लाइड है, ये पीपीटी ये स्लाइड दिख रहा है सर, जोड़ रहा
ऑडिबल 18 सर इपुड़
हाँ सर
18
18 हाँ ओके। तो इन केस ऑफ सीमॉस इन्वर्टर इफ इनपुट इज चेंजिंग फ्रॉम 0 to 1 देन दी पुल डाउन ट्रांसिस्टर ऑफ सीमॉस इज ऑन स्टेट, दी कैपेसिटर स्टार्ट्स डिस्चार्जिंग थ्रू दिस पुल डाउन ट्रांसिस्टर एंड द डिस्चार्जिंग टाइम कांस्टेंट इज गिवन बाय 2 इनटू आरएस इनटू बॉक्स सीजी, दिस आरएस इनटू बॉक्स इज रिप्लेस्ड बाय ए टाइम कांस्टेंट। एट द सेम टाइम द पुल अप ट्रांसिस्टर ऑफ सेकंड सीमॉस इन्वर्टर इज ऑन एंड द कैपेसिटर स्टार्ट्स चार्जिंग थ्रू दिस पुल अप ट्रांसिस्टर, इन दिस केस द चार्जिंग टाइम कांस्टेंट इज गिवन बाय द शीट रेसिस्टेंस ऑफ पीमॉस ट्रांसिस्टर इज 25 किलो ओम्स which is equals to 2.5 times of NMOS transistor. That's why this value is multiplied by 2.5 into RS into box CZ, which is equals to 5 tau. The total time constant is charging time constant and plus discharging time constant, which is equals to 7 tau. Now, whenever input is changing from 1 to 0, the capacitor starts charging. In this case, we are getting the rise time. From this, we can calculate the rise time formula. Similarly, when the input is changing from 0 to 1, the pull down transistor is in on position. In this case, the
सर भैया सॉरी टू इंटरप्ट, स्लाइड शो बेटा, माँ पुट स्लाइड शो, स्लाइड शो बेटा है स्लाइड
స్లైడ్ షో అనేది పెట్టాను సార్.
స్లైడ్ షో కనిపించలేదు, స్లైడ్ షో కాదు ఇది, ఇది ఓన్లీ నువ్వు సెపరేట్ గా నాకు లెఫ్ట్ సైడ్ ఫుల్ స్క్రీన్ కనిపించలేదు, స్లైడ్ షో ఉంటుంది చూడు కింద.
సార్ ఇప్పుడు కనిపిస్తుందా సార్?
ఒక నిమిషం. స్లైడ్ షో ప్రెస్ చేసావా?
ప్రెస్ చేశాను సార్, నాకు మాక్సిమైజ్ చూపిస్తుంది సార్ ఇక్కడ.
అంటే నాకు మాకు డిలే ఉంది, నాకు డిలే ఉందేమో, నేను ఎప్పుడు జాయిన్ అయ్యాను నాకు క్లిక్ చేయి, క్లిక్ చేస్తున్నావు అది, నువ్వు నువ్వు చూస్తున్నావు క్లిక్ చేస్తున్నట్టు చిన్న డిలే ఉంటుంది నాకు.
మళ్ళీ క్లిక్ చేశాను సార్ కనిపించింది. సార్ కనిపిస్తుందా సార్ ఇప్పుడు?
నాకైతే మామూలుగానే ఉంది ప్రెజెంటేషన్, స్లైడ్స్ పక్కన లెఫ్ట్ సైడ్ అన్ని కనిపిస్తున్నాయి, స్లైడ్ షో లాగా సింగిల్ స్లైడ్ కనిపించట్లే. మరి ఐ డోంట్ నో అబౌట్ ది శేషయ్య, ఉన్నావు నువ్వు? నీకు కనిపిస్తుందా?
హలో
శేషు, స్లైడ్ స్లైడ్ షో కనిపించట్లేదయ్యా శివయ్య?
సార్ 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 చూస్తాను సార్ ఒకసారి.
అక్కడ కింద నీకు స్లైడ్ షో అది ప్రెస్ చేయి, స్లైడ్ షో
ప్రెస్ చేశాను సార్, ప్రెస్
అది
చేశాను సార్.
అవ్వట్లేదా ఏంటి?
నాకు మాక్సిమైజ్ చూపిస్తుంది.
ఇప్పుడు వచ్చింది లేవై, ఇప్పుడు చెప్పు మళ్ళీ స్లైడ్కి వెళ్ళి మళ్ళీ. ఓకే వెరీ గుడ్, కంటిన్యూ చేయి, సారీ ఫర్ ఇంటరప్షన్. ఓకే
ఓకే సార్. లైక్ కంటిన్యూ సార్.
ప్లీజ్ ప్లీజ్ యూ కెన్ కంటిన్యూ, నో ప్రాబ్లమ్. ఓకేనా?
నెక్స్ట్ టాపిక్ ఇస్ డ్రైవింగ్ లార్జ్ కెపాసిటివ్ లోడ్స్. ఇఫ్ ది కెపాసిటెన్స్ వాల్యూ ఇస్ లార్జ్ దెన్ ది టైమ్ కాన్స్టెంట్ ఇస్ గివెన్ బై రెసిస్టెన్స్ ఇన్ టు కెపాసిటెన్స్. ఇఫ్ కెపాసిటెన్స్ ఇస్ లార్జ్ దెన్ ది టైమ్ కాన్స్టెంట్ ఇస్ లార్జ్. ఇఫ్ టైమ్ కాన్స్టెంట్ ఇస్ లార్జ్ దెన్ ది డిలే ఈస్ మోర్. దట్స్ వై టు డ్రైవింగ్ లార్జ్ కెపాసిటివ్ లోడ్స్ వీ కెన్ యూస్ త్రీ మెథడ్స్. ది ఫస్ట్ వన్ ఈస్ క్యాస్కేడెడ్ ఇన్వర్టర్స్ యాజ్ డ్రైవర్స్, సెకండ్ వన్ ఈస్ సూపర్ బఫర్స్ అండ్ థర్డ్ వన్ ఈస్ బై సీమాస్ డ్రైవర్స్. ఇన్ కేస్ ఆఫ్ క్యాస్కేడెడ్ ఇన్వర్టర్స్ యాజ్ డ్రైవర్, ది ఫస్ట్ ఇన్వర్టర్ ఈజ్ లెస్ సైజ్ కంపేర్డ్ టు ది సెకండ్ ఇన్వర్టర్ అండ్ ది సెకండ్ ఇన్వర్టర్ ఈజ్ లెస్ సైజ్ కంపేర్డ్ టు ది థర్డ్ ఇన్వర్టర్. ఇన్ ఆర్డర్ టు రెడ్యూస్ ది డిలే టైమ్ ఐ కెన్ యూస్ ది లో ఎల్ ఈస్ టు డబ్ల్యూ రేషియో, బట్ వీ కెనాట్ ఇంక్రీజ్ ది ఎల్ వాల్యూ. బట్ ఇన్ ఆర్డర్ టు లోయర్ ది ఎల్ ఈస్ టు డబ్ల్యూ రేషియో ఐ కెన్ ఇంక్రీజ్ ది విత్ ఫ్యాక్టర్ ఓన్లీ. ఇఫ్ విత్ ఫ్యాక్టర్ ఈస్ ఇంక్రీజింగ్ దెన్ ది నెంబర్ ఆఫ్ ట్రాన్సిస్టర్ ఆర్ డిక్రీజింగ్ ఓన్లీ. Both are complement to each other. In this case, you already discussed the total delay for NMOS pair is 5 tau and the total delay for CMOS pair is 7 tau. By using super buffer also we can drive the large capacitive loads. In this case, first one is non-inverting NMOS super buffer. In this case, if V input is equals to logic 1, then the transistor T2 and T4 are on. The depletion mode transistor is in always on position and this T3 transistor is in off position only. In this case, we are getting output is equals to logic 0. Input is logic 1 and output we are getting logic 0. That's why it is called as a inverting NMOS super buffer. Similarly, if input is logic 0, this transistor and T4 transistor are off and the transistor T1 and T3 are on. In this case, VDD is transferred to the output side. We are getting output as logic 1. If input is logic 0, we are getting output is logic 1. That's why it is called as a inverting NMOS super buffer. By using this super buffer, we can maintain the rise time and fall time very, very small only compared to the previous case. Similarly, non-inverting NMOS super buffer. In this case, your input is equals to logic 0. Then this transistor and this transistor is off. And the transistor T1 and T4 are on position. In this case, we are getting output is logic 0 because VDD, this transistor is connected to the ground only. We are getting V output is equals to 0. If input is logic 0, then we are getting output is logic 0. That's why it is called as a non-inverting buffer. Similarly, if input is logic 1, then this transistor and this transistor is on. The remaining two transistors are off position. In this case, V output is we are getting logic 1 only. Input is logic 1, output is also logic 1. That's why we are getting. In this case also, for example, if I'm using a 5 micrometer technology, which are capable of driving loads of 2 picofarad with 5 nanoseconds rise time only. That's why this is called as a super buffer with having very less rise time and fall time. By using BiCMOS drivers also, we can drive the large capacitive loads. In case of BiCMOS, we can combine both the advantages of CMOS and BJT. And another one is collector resistance. Look at this graph. As collector resistance is increasing, the delay is manageable if the load capacitor value is equals to 0.1 nanofarad. If the capacitor value is large, then the delay is more only. Next one, propagation delay. If the pass transistors are connected in cascaded manner and the number of pass transistors are increases, then the delay is also increase only. Anyway, this pass transistor is replaced by its equivalent circuit, resistor and capacitor. And calculate the total time delay, we are getting n square rs into tau, where r is the relative resistance for each stage and c is the relative capacitance for each stage. Look at this another one. Each transistor is replaced by a resistor and a capacitor. So the overall delay increases as the number of transistors increases. That's why more than 4 pass transistors should be normally connected in series only. Next one, wiring capacitance. There are 3 types of wiring capacitance. First one is fringing fields. Second one is interlayer capacitance. Third one is peripheral capacitance. Fringing fields capacitance is due to two parallel metal lines running across the chip for power supply connections. Most of the wiring capacitance is due to fringing fields only. Next one is interlayer capacitance. Interlayer capacitance is due to different layers crossing each other. Anyway, this capacitance is neglected. It is easy to estimate. Next one is peripheral capacitance. Peripheral capacitance is occurred at the junction of two devices. For example, the source and drain regions of N-type forms a junction with a P-substrate. Similarly, source and drain regions of P-substrate or P-type forms a junction with N-substrate. The next one is scaling. Scaling is defined as changing the dimensions both horizontally and vertically by varying the doping levels and voltages. There are 3 types of scaling models. constant voltage and dimension scaling, constant field scaling, and last one is constant voltage scaling. In case of constant voltage and dimension scaling, all the parameters are scaled by 1 by alpha.
Hello? All the students are
mute your microphones. Please, all the students are mute your microphones. All the students are mute your microphones. Some noise is there. Please mute your microphones. Okay. In case of constant field and voltage scaling, see, supply voltage is equals to, before scaling I can be written as a VDD, after scaling I can be written as a VDD dash. VDD dash can be written as VDD by beta, because voltage is scaled by 1 by beta. Here the scaling factor is what? 1 by beta only. When comes to constant field scaling, this beta is replaced by alpha. That's why we are getting scaling factor is equals to 1 by alpha. In constant voltage scaling, this beta is replaced by 1. That's why we are getting 1 is the scaling factor. Similarly, we can calculate all these parameters. For example, the gate capacitance is scaling factor is beta by alpha square. When comes to constant field scaling, this beta is replaced by alpha only. That means alpha by alpha square, alpha get cancelled. Remaining scaling factor is what? 1 by alpha. In case of constant voltage scaling, this beta is replaced by 1 only. That's why we are getting scaling factor is equals to 1 by alpha square. There are so many advantages of scaling. Density is high, power consumption is less, speed is high, and some drawbacks also. These are the limitations of scaling: substrate doping and depletion width, limits of miniaturization, limits of interconnect and contact resistance, limits due to subthreshold currents, etc. This is our third unit. Next, we move on to the sixth unit. First, I will discuss sixth unit. Introduction to low power VLSI design. See, the submicron technology means 1 micrometer, 0.8 micrometer, 0.6 micrometer, and 0.5 micrometer, etc. The technology is 1 micrometer. It indicates the channel length is 1 micrometer. Keep this point in mind. Next one, deep submicron technology means 0.35 micrometer, 0.25 micrometer, 0.18 micrometer, etc. Ultra deep submicron technology means 90 nanometer, 65 nanometer, and 45 nanometer, and 32 nanometer. As we are moving from submicron technology to deep submicron technology and ultra deep submicron technology, the device dimensions are decreases. As the device dimensions decreases, the number of transistors present on the chip increases. That means power density increases. As power density increases, power dissipation is also increases. This is one drawback. And another parameter is a clock frequency. For example, in case of 8086 microprocessor and 8051 microcontroller, we are using a clock frequency in the order of few megahertz only. Nowadays, all the mobile phones or laptops consisting the processors of gigahertz frequency only. The purpose of increasing the clock frequency is increasing the speed only, but it indirectly increases the power dissipation. That's why we have to study low power VLSI design. Anyway, the drawbacks of deep submicron technology is more power dissipation. Testing is difficult due to large number of transistor, and the reliability of circuit decreases. Next one, overview of power consumption. There are three types of power dissipations or power consumptions. First one, switching or dynamic power dissipation, short circuit power dissipation, leakage power dissipation. The power dissipation is occurred due to the transition of output node voltage is called dynamic power dissipation. For example, look at this diagram. If input is changing from 0 to 1, then The p-mos transistor is off and n-mos transistor is on. In this case, the capacitor starts discharging through this transistor. Similarly, if input is changing from 1 to 0, the p-mos transistor is on and n-mos transistor is off. In this case, this capacitor starts charging through this p-mos transistor. That's why during this transition, capacitor is discharged. During this transition, capacitor is charging only. The power dissipation is occurred at these transition is called as a dynamic power dissipation. We can calculate the dynamic power dissipation by using average power calculation formula. We are getting the equation as alpha into C VDD square into F, where alpha is a switching factor, C is a capacitance value, and VDD is the supply voltage, F is equals to clock frequency. Our intention is to reduce the power dissipation, which is possible by reducing any one of these parameters. Next one is short circuit power dissipation. The power dissipation is occurred when both PMOS and NMOS transistors are on. If input is changing from 0 to 1, then the output is changing from 1 to 0. During this transition, at a short interval of time, both PMOS and NMOS transistors are on and a short circuit is provided. This power dissipation is called as a short circuit power dissipation. Look at the figure 1, in which input is changing from 1 to 0 and output is changing from 0 to 1. During this transition, both the transistors are on only. Both the transistors are on. Look at figure B. In this case, the load capacitor is a small value. If load capacitor is a small value, then the delay is also small because the time constant is equal to resistance multiplied by this capacitance only. If input is changing, within no time, the output is also changing. That's why we are getting both PMOS and NMOS transistors are on. That's why we are getting short circuit current is high at this transition. Similarly, we are getting short circuit current is high. How to eliminate this short circuit power dissipation? Look at this figure C. In this case, I'm taking the load capacitor is a large value. If load capacitor is large, then the delay is more. In that case, if input is doesn't change from 1 to 0, it takes some time due to this large delay. In this way, we can eliminate both the transistors are on. That's why we are getting short circuit current is very, very small only. Next one is leakage power dissipation. In case of a CMOS inverter construction, this is the diagram. If I can connect the input is VDD, VDD is nothing but logic 1 only. That's why NMOS transistor is on and the PMOS transistor is off. In this case, it forms a reverse bias PN junction with P plus and N substrate. Similarly for N well and P substrate. Why I can call it as a reverse bias PN junction diode? Because in case of PMOS, the substrate is connected to the supply voltage. Supply voltage is VDD. That means N well is connected to the VDD. That's why it is called as a reverse biased PN junction. Due to this reverse biased PN junction, a reverse leakage current is flowing between P plus and N well. Similarly, N well and P substrate. When it comes to second one, this circuit is operated under subthreshold region. Subthreshold region means a weak inversion region, in which the carriers or the electrons flows from source region to drain region. We know that current direction is opposite to the flow of electrons. That way, the subthreshold leakage current is flowing from drain region to source region. These are the reasons for the leakage power dissipation. That is reverse leakage current and subthreshold leakage current. Anyway, in this unit, we can discuss how to reduce the power dissipation. First one is low power design through voltage scaling. We know that dynamic power dissipation is directly proportional to square of the supply voltage. If supply voltage is scaled down, then the power dissipation is also decreased only. Look at this diagram. The power supply is decreasing in this direction. Yeah, this power all the students mute your microphone. The supply voltage is decreasing in this direction, then the power dissipation is also decreases only. But it leads to one drawback. As supply voltage is decreases, power dissipation is decreases, but delay is increases. To overcome this problem, anyway, this diagram is drawn at threshold voltage is equals to 0.8 volts. The supply voltage is decreases, then the delay is increases. To overcome that problem, I can reduce the threshold voltage. See here, if threshold voltage is equals to 0.8 volts, this is the delay. If threshold voltage is equals to 0.4 volts, the delay is minimized only. But here also there is a limitation. The threshold voltage cannot be decreased below 0.2 volts. What is happening if the threshold voltage is less than 0.2 volts? It leads to two drawbacks. The first drawback is noise margin decreases, and the second drawback is subthreshold conduction takes place. Subthreshold conduction takes place, that is, leakage current increases and the power dissipation increases. To overcome these two drawbacks, I go for two circuits, VT CMOS and MT CMOS, that is variable threshold CMOS circuit. For PMOS transistor, the threshold voltage is negative. For NMOS transistor, the threshold voltage is positive. We know the body effect means if the source to body voltage is not equals to zero, then the body effect is present. In case of active mode, listen, see this circuit diagram. This PMOS of source is connected to 2 volts and the body voltage is equals to 2 volts in active mode. That means 2 volts minus 2 volts, VSB is equals to 0 volts, there is no body effect. Similarly, for NMOS transistor, the source voltage is 0 volts, and in case of active mode, it is equals to 0 volts. 0 minus 0, VSB is equals to 0 volts, there is no body effect. If body effect is not present, then threshold voltage is decreases. Threshold voltage decreases means the delay is low only. Anyway, the circuit is operated with 2 voltage supply. That means low supply voltage leads to low power dissipation, low threshold voltage leads to low delay. That means the circuit is operating very speed only. What about the substrate bias control circuit? The substrate bias control circuit increases the body voltage of a PMOS to 4 volts and decreases the body voltage of a NMOS to minus 2 volts. In this case, we can calculate the source to body voltage. Source voltage is 2 and body voltage is equals to 4. 2 volts minus 4 volts, which is equals to minus 2 volts. That means source to body voltage is not equals to 0. Then there is a body effect. Here also source to body voltage not equals to 0, the body effect is present. If the body effect is present, then the threshold voltage is increases. Threshold voltage is increasing means what? Delay is increase only. And power dissipation is also increase only. That is called as a standby mode or a sleep mode. That means under working, not working condition. Why the name is called as a variable threshold CMOS? The substrate bias control circuit varies this body voltage, which varies this threshold voltage. That's why the name is called as a variable threshold CMOS. The drawback of this VT CMOS is the fabrication of MOS transistors with different threshold voltage is possible only with twin tub and triple well technology. To overcome this problem, we are moving on to the multiple threshold CMOS. In active mode, these high threshold voltage transistors are on, then the CMOS logic with low threshold voltage is responsible for low power consumption and high speed operation. Low power consumption is due to low supply voltage, high speed operation is due to low threshold voltage. When it comes to standby mode, these two transistors are off, then there is no short circuit from VDD to ground terminal, which eliminates the leakage current. That means prevents the sub-threshold leakage in standby mode. But the drawback of this circuit is the presence of series connection of these standby transistors increases the area. If area increases, then the capacitance increases. That is the drawback of empty CMOS. Next one is estimation and optimization of switching activity. Switching activity means the transition of output node is either from 0 to 1 or 1 to 0. In this case, we can consider 0 to 1 only. P naught is the probability of output is having logic 0. And P1 is the probability having output is logic 1. The transition probability is given by the product of these two probabilities, P0 and P1. Let us consider a two input NOR gate. It is having the truth table. Only one output is having logic 1. Remaining three cases are output as logic 0 only. That's why for two input NOR gate, P0 is given by 3 by 4. Favorable cases is 3 and total number of cases are 4. Similarly, P1 is given by 1 by 4 and the transition probability is multiplication of these two, that is 3 by 16. Now, draw a graph between number of inputs and output transition probability. If number of inputs is equal to 2, then the transition probability either 0 to 1 or 1 to 0 is given by 3 by 16. 3 by 16 means it is almost equal to 0.2 only. If number of inputs are increasing, then what about the output transition probability? For example, three input NOR gate. In three input NOR gate, output is having logic 1 only one case. Remaining seven cases are output is logic 0 only. That's why for three input NOR gate, P0 is 7 by 8, P1 is 1 by 8. The transition probability is multiplication of these two, which is nearer to this 0.1 only. That's why as number of inputs are increasing, then the output transition probability is decreasing for both NAND gate and NOR gate. When it comes to XOR, XNOR gate, the output of XNOR and XOR table is having equal number of combinations as output is logic 0 and output is logic 1. That's why we are getting transition probabilities 0.5 for any number of inputs. If input number of inputs are 3 or 4 or 5, equal number of output combinations are possible. That's why we are getting transition probability is constant at 0.25. Next one is reduction of switching activity. First one is algorithmic optimization. This one is mainly depends on the applications only. For example, characteristics of data, such as statistics of data, correlation. Based on this data, we can reduce the switching activity also. For example, some of the techniques uses the digital signal processor for the special purpose applications, but it cannot be used for the general purpose application. If a vector quantization algorithm is used, then the switching activity is reduced only. The number of multiplications and the number of additions, memory access are decreases. If a differential tree search algorithm is used instead of binary search algorithm. Next one is glitch reduction. In a multi-level logic circuit, the propagation delay from one logic block to another logic block can cause spurious signal transitions. These are called as a glitches. See, look at this diagram. These three inputs are applied simultaneously. That means these three inputs are available at the same time, but the D input is available after some delay because the D is the output of the previous logic gate only. Because of this delay, we are getting a glitches only. Similarly, here a four input XOR gate is implemented by using a chain structure. That means all the inputs are not occurring at the same time.
Here, sir, exams are cancelled, sir.
Hello? 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 Listen, in this case, the glitches are more when the four input XOR gate is implemented by using a tree structure. In this case, glitches are small only because all the inputs are occurred simultaneously. Next one is gated clock signals. A n-bit magnitude comparator can be explained with the gated class signal. If both MSBs of these two numbers are different, then the XNOR gate produces output is logic zero, then there is no clock signal for this section. If both MSBs are different, then the decision is made by the MSB comparator. No need of comparing the remaining bits. In second case, both MSBs are same, then the XNOR gate generates the output is logic one, and a clock signal is provided for the lower n-1 bit registers through the AND gate, which is responsible for which number is greater is decided by the n-1 bit comparator only. If both bits are different, the decision is made by the MSB comparator. In this case, the clock signal is disabled. If MSB bits are same, then the decision is made by the n-1 bit comparator. In this case, clock signal is enabled. Based on condition only, we can apply the clock signal. Next one is reduction of switching capacitance. There are three types: system level measures, circuit level measures, and mask level measures. In system level measures, the switching capacitance can be reduced to limit the use of shared resources only. Look at this figure. Here, all the modules share with the same bus. In this case, the switching capacitance is large only. When comes to second figure, in this case, the global bus can be partitioned into some local dedicated buses. In this case, the switching capacitance is small compared to the figure A. In case of circuit level measures, the capacitance is a function of number of transistor to implement a logic function. For example, if I want to implement an XOR gate, by using a standard CMOS logic, I can require more than 10 transistors. When comes to pass transistor logic, an XOR gate can be implemented by using only 4 transistors. If number of transistors are less, then the circuit, then the capacitance is also less only. Next one is a mask level measures. In mask level measures, the capacitance is minimized by reducing the dimensions of a transistor. Especially the source and the drain regions can be minimized, but the performance is decreases only. Hence, we have to provide a trade-off between power dissipation and dynamic performance. Next unit is FPGA design. FPGA means what? Field programmable gate array. Field programmable means the functionality is defined by the user program rather than the manufacturer of the device. Gate array means it consists an array of logic gates, and these are connected according to the logic we have to be implement. Anyway, there are two modes of FPGA. First one is configuration mode and second one is user mode. Whenever the power is turned on and the code is loaded, that is, then the FPGA is in configuration mode. Once configuration is completed, then the FPGA goes into the user mode only. Here we can perform our actual operation. Next one, FPGA design flow. First one is a specification. In this, I am going to implement an off-adder. That is, the specification is design an off-adder circuit, which consists of two inputs and two outputs, sum and carry output. Next step is a design entry. The design entry may be a VHDL code or Verilog code or schematic diagram. That is called as a design entry. For example, if I can write the VHDL code for the off-adder, after that, this code is working properly or not, by verifying the simulation only. That simulation is called as a functional simulation. In this, we are getting the outputs for sum output and carry output. Once this one is completed, next one is a synthesis. Synthesis means generating a hardware circuit for your VHDL code. In this case, we are getting, anyway, we know that off adder contains the XOR gate and AND gate. Here, we are getting hardware circuit of off adder. After that, we go for the verification. That verification is called as a post-synthesis simulation. Here also we are getting the sum output and carry output, whether the hardware circuit
हेलो सर सर
हेलो सूर्या सूर्या
हाँ यस हेलो सर मीटिंग ఉందా లేదా
సార్ ఎందుకు అయ్యారా
ఎందుకు ఈ మీటింగ్ ఎగ్జామ్ అయినప్పుడు ఎగ్జామ్స్ క్యాన్సిల్ అయినప్పుడు ఈ పనులు ఏంది వెళ్ళండి అందరూ ఎందుకు పనులు లేవా
మిస్టర్ శేషయ్య
హలో
శేషయ్య ఆర్ యు దేర్ శేషయ్య వాట్ హ్యాపెన్ టు శివయ్య ఎక్కడ నెట్వర్క్ ఏమైనా ప్రాబ్లం వచ్చిందా ఏంటి జాయిన్ అవుతాడు ఓకే ఓకే జాయిన్ అవుతాడు పారు స్టూడెంట్స్ కొంచెం ఇంపార్టెంట్ పనులు ఉంటే కొంచెం పక్కన పెట్టి కాస్త వెయిట్ చేయండి సార్ జాయిన్ అవుతారు ఓకేనా సారీ ఫర్ ది ఇన్కన్వీనియన్స్
ఇరవై ఆరు